Welcome to our worship service this weekend. It's good to have you all here. It's good to have those with us online watching as well. Good to be in the house of the Lord together. Today is Christ the King Sunday. It's the last Sunday of the church year and a time for us to remember that our Savior is the one who rules over all things. He is the one in control. That's a good thing to end the church year with. It's a good thing to end every year with, especially looking at this year, 2020, when there have been so many things that have probably caused us all to question, Lord, what is going on here? Are you still in charge? Well, our readings today give us a firm answer to that. Yes, he is still in charge, even though it doesn't always look like it. As we talk about our sermon text, we'll see that Jesus was actually at his most glorious, you could say, at a time when he looked very much not glorious or kingly. So that's what we'll get to focus on today in our worship as we say, Hail, King Jesus. We'll begin our worship this weekend with an anthem by our third and fourth grade choir from our Lutheran Elementary School. They'll start us off with an anthem called Let Us Go to the House of the Lord, a good way to start our worship. So God bless our worship together. Now join to honor our Savior King with the words of the invocation for Christ the King Sunday. You may remain seated. I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters, and like loud peals of thunder, shouting, Hallelujah, for our Lord God omnipotent reigns. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We join now in our opening hymn, Jerusalem the Golden. One, two,
am the golden with milk and honey best. The sight of it refreshes the weary and oppressed. I know not what joy awaits us there.
We gather for worship the same way we were baptized, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As believers in Christ, we are called to repent of our sins and forgive one another. In the book of James, we're told, "Therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for one another so that you may be healed." As one body in Christ, we unite our hearts in prayer. Lord, I pray to you because I am suffering. I have cut myself off from you and others by the sin in my life. I need your forgiveness so that I may find healing for my wounded life and for the wounds I have caused others. Today, in the name of Jesus, I pray, forgive me, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, renew my heart. Amen.
Jesus. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the
We take comfort and find confidence in the words of Jesus. He sent me to announce forgiveness to the prisoners of sin, to restore sight to the blind, to bring mercy to lives shattered by sin, to announce the favor of the Lord. God gave his only Son, Jesus, to die for our sins and rise from death to give us eternal life. We are forgiven. We live in the favor of the Lord. We live in his power, energized to tell of his peace. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to
Please be seated. Our first lesson for this weekend is recorded for us in the book of Daniel, chapter 7, verses 9 and 10, where we get a picture of God being in charge there on the last day as all his angels surround him, as all the peoples of all the world are there standing before him, and he judges the nations. So no doubt that God is in control there. No doubt that he's in control right now either. As I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was as white as snow, The hair of his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were opened. This is the word of our God. We'll continue with an anthem by the choir. My heart is filled with thankfulness. Continue now with the children's message. Those watching online, children gather around so that you can see and hear too. We've got some kids here with us today, so I'm going to ask you, how many of you like family vacations? You guys like family vacations? Yeah? What kind of places do you like to go to? Matthew, what kind of places do you like to go to? California, all right. Yeah? Okay. You ever go to Disneyland out there? Okay. All right. How about, go ahead, Noah. What about you? Where's that? Texas? All right. Cool. Yes. It's fun to go places, especially if you've never been there before, or it's fun to go and be with family, right? You really look forward to those times when you get to go on vacation and be somewhere special. But a lot of times, it takes something to get there, right? How many of you have to sit in the car for hours? Yeah. Uh-huh. Is that fun? Yeah. I mean, we try to do the best we can, right, to occupy ourselves, to find ways to make the car trip fun. But let's face it, it's just not always going to be fun, is it? Because maybe there's other siblings in the car and they get on your nerves, right? Or maybe it's too hot in the car or it's too cold in the car. Maybe you get really hungry and there's not enough food in the car. Okay, I'm getting some nods on that one. Maybe you got to go to the bathroom and the next rest stop is like 50 miles away. There's lots of things that can make the car ride miserable. On top of all, maybe we just run out of things to do, right? We read through our book already, we watched a movie already, and we're just bored, right? And so we just feel like this is this endless amount of suffering that we have to go to, and we just want to get there already, right? And so that's when we start asking the adults, right? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? And then you know how that makes them feel. So it's not a fun time all the time in the car, is it? But we do get to look ahead. We look forward to that time when finally we get there. Finally we get to enjoy the vacation, the family, the fun stuff, whatever it is. That's a lot like our journey in this world towards heaven, too. Because we know there's something good waiting there for us. But we're not there yet. We're still on the road, so to speak. We're still trying to get there. And there's all kinds of things that make that journey not so much fun, right? Because of sin. Because of our sin. Because of other people's sin. It makes that journey not much fun a lot of the time. The comforting thing with that is that Jesus took that journey too. And Jesus didn't have a lot of fun doing it either. And we're going to get a bigger picture of that today as we talk in our sermon. But we're going to see all the suffering that he had to go through. I mean, it was not fun. And obviously, he ended by dying on the cross before he could enter into that glory after he rose from the dead. So it's comforting to know that our Savior went through it, and he's going to help us through it. It's comforting to know that because he went through it, we know that we're going to get through it too. That's what our whole faith is founded upon, right? So look to Jesus when life gets tough, kids. Look to him and remember what he went through so that you would finally get to that final awesome destination of heaven. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for living life in this world, for going through the same journey that we do, and for winning salvation for us and assuring for us that one day we'll get to be there in heaven with you, sharing your victory. We pray it in your name. Amen. Continue with our second lesson written for us in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15. We hear about Christ here, whose resurrection guarantees our own resurrection, and see how he is reigning even now, and he will reign all the way until the end, until all our enemies are finally defeated. And death is that final enemy that needs to be defeated. Here we get the picture of Jesus doing that. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. But each in turn, Christ the first fruits, then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. for he has put everything under his feet. Now, when it says that everything has been put under him, it's clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. When he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. This, too, is God's word. We continue with our sermon hymn, Jesus Shall Reign.
Jesus shall reign where'er the sun does its successive journeys run. His kingdom stretch from shore to shore, till sun shall rise and set no abound where'er he reigns. The prisoners leap to those his chains. The weary find the eternal rest. And all the sons of ones are blessed. To our King be highest grace.
Grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, our King. Your brothers and sisters, my slides didn't make it in. That's okay. How many of you know the origin of the military salute? Anyone? No takers? That's actually probably good, because I couldn't find the origin either. There's a lot of theories out there. Some people think that it was just a way of shortening things up. Rather than taking your hat or helmet off when a superior came, you just put your hand up instead. Or Some think it dates back to the medieval times when they had visors on their helmets, and that was just a way to, you know, they flipped up their visor when the superior came by as a way to identify themselves, who they were. Or some even think that it was a way of shielding their eyes from the dazzling splendor of their superior. That one seems maybe a little far-fetched. There's lots of other theories out there, too. You can look them up for yourselves. But today, we get to take a look at Jesus and the salute that he receives. Not the kind of salute that anyone would be looking for. The salute that the soldiers give to Jesus after his trial before the Sanhedrin and then Pontius Pilate. This was not a respectful salute. This was a bloody salute, a sarcastic salute, a demeaning salute, full of mockery and ridicule and physical violence. And looking at Jesus in that moment, we may wonder, how can he be king? And yet what we're going to see is that he is king. He is king, even though he never looked less kingly than at this moment. What we're going to see is, the truth of the matter is, he was never more kingly than at this moment. And so our theme for today and what we're considering is how we address and honor our king. We say, "Hail King Jesus," because you truly show that you are our king. We're going to take a look at the words before us. They're written for us in Matthew chapter 27, and they won't be up on the screen for you, but you can follow along in your service folder or open up a Bible if you're at home and take a look. Matthew 27, verses 27 through 31. We read, "Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. 'Hail, King of the Jews,' they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him." This is the gospel of our Lord. Now, Jesus never looked less regal than at this time. Pilate had just passed sentence. He had already had Jesus flogged. And now he hands him over to the soldiers to prepare him for the crucifixion and have them take him out to Golgotha. And the soldiers take advantage of this opportunity to make sport, have a little fun with this prisoner, this criminal, this one that they certainly do not see as a king. And it's interesting because if they would have known Jesus his whole life through, they would have seen hints. They would have seen examples of his kingship. I mean, we see them all over the Gospels. Take a run through your memory of what's in there. You go back to the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew and you see when Jesus is born, how the wise men come to him from the east, right? Following that star, and when they arrive in Jerusalem, they say, "We're looking for the newborn King of the Jews." People already at Jesus' birth knew that he was a king, even though he certainly looked nothing like it, and his surroundings certainly didn't give any indication of it. And when Jesus is an adult, we see more examples of it. We see Jesus performing his miracles, right? Things like calming the storm on the Sea of Galilee, saving his disciples' lives. Here is a man who has control over the very elements of nature. Would we say he's in charge? Would we say, here's a king? I think so. Or on the Mount of Transfiguration, when Jesus gives his disciples a glimpse of the real glory that he has, there we see Jesus as king. Or just a few days before the account that we read, when Jesus rides into Jerusalem and is honored as a king. Hosanna to the Son of David. A kingly title. So if the soldiers would have known about all these events, yeah, they might have treated Jesus a little bit differently. Who knows? But this is not the kind of royal treatment that they give to Jesus. Here was a man that, when they looked at him, they saw someone who had none of the trappings of royalty. There's no army behind this man. He's not dressed the part. He doesn't have the wealth of kings. Instead, he's a condemned criminal. So they treat him as such. But because they've heard that this man calls himself a king, they decide to play off of that. They strip him down, and they throw a red robe around him, probably a robe that one of the soldiers themselves was wearing. That was a common part of the uniform for a Roman soldier. They give him a crown, but a crown of thorns, something that would be sure to cause pain and suffering. And then they give him a staff, a mock scepter. And then they kneel before him. They say, "Hail, King of the Jews." They mock him. They spit on him. They beat him again and again. That's the kind of treatment Jesus received from these soldiers. It was physical. It was psychological. It was emotional. And when we look at that, we maybe remember these verses from Isaiah 53. As we see him, Jesus here, he's a helpless victim, seemingly so. And these words from Isaiah come to mind. "Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not." Yeah, people might have lifted their hands to their faces when they saw Jesus, but not to honor him or salute him, but to hide the sight of him because it was so grisly. And then think about Jesus' followers at that time when they knew what was happening to him. No doubt they were deeply grieved by it. They were saddened by what was going on. But do you think they were maybe also a little disappointed? You know, the disciples were often ones asking Jesus about the time that he was going to show all his glory to the people of the world and prove them wrong and finally establish his rule, right? They mistakenly were looking for a kingdom on earth. Even at the time of Jesus' ascension, right, they asked him, "Lord, is it at this time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" And so to see him or know that he is under this condemnation, that he's been flogged and beaten, and that he's not doing anything to stop it, maybe they were a bit disappointed. Jesus looked like a failure. They didn't understand, though, that before the crown comes the cross. And maybe that's something you and I struggle with at times too. As we live our lives in this world, as we deal with all the things that we have to deal with, all the consequences of sin in our lives, do we at times question Jesus and wonder, "Jesus, are you really in charge? Are you really king? Sure doesn't look like it. Not right now." As you look at 2020 and all that's gone on, maybe we especially ask that question. "Jesus, what are you trying to do with all this COVID stuff? Jesus, what about that election? There's a lot of people torn up about that. Our country's kind of in a shambles as far as unity goes. Jesus, what's that all about? Are you really in charge?" racial tensions. And then we can take it to personal life too. Lord, why'd you let my loved one get sick? I thought you were in charge. I thought you were taking care of us. Lord, with everything that's happened, you know, I own a business or I work a job, and with all this COVID stuff, now I don't have that. My finances are in a shambles. Lord, how could you let this happen? Aren't you in charge? When suffering comes our way, it's common for our first reaction to be doubt and disappointment rather than courage and hope and confidence in our Savior King. I mean, I think it is true that to a degree we expect the glory already now. Jesus, come on, we're your people. Shouldn't you treat us a little better? Make our lives a little nicer? And there are certainly churches that teach that. But that's not what Jesus teaches. In fact, after his resurrection, he's walking and talking with those Emmaus disciples. Remember that? And they're just flabbergasted. They're like, we thought this was the one. We thought he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. But now all this happened. And remember what he says to them? He says, how foolish you are and slow to understand. Didn't the Christ have to suffer all these things and then enter into his glory? Don't you think that Jesus would say the same to us? How foolish you are. How slow to understand. Didn't I tell you that first comes the cross and then the glory? And we get to make a real nice connection here because our very congregation teaches this point, doesn't it? The name of our congregation, Cross of Glory. That's all encapsulated right there. First, the cross. First comes suffering. First comes what Jesus went through. We also get to go through. The students are like the master. But that doesn't mean that we don't get glimpses of his glory even now. Just like the disciples got glimpses while they lived with him and learned from him, we get glimpses of his glory too. He sometimes lets that shine through the clouds of heaven, right? And we get just massive encouragement from those times when we see clearly, yeah, Jesus, I get it now. Yeah, I see what you were doing there. You are in charge. Praise be to you. And he gives us those glimpses to remind us that he's in charge, to encourage us along our way, because he knows it's hard. He knows it's hard. He went through it himself. But because he went through it himself, he also knows just how to encourage us, just how to keep us in his care. And so we say, Hail, King Jesus. Yeah, you never looked less regal than you did at this moment, right? Beaten, bloody, ridiculed, looks like a failure. But the fact of the matter is that he was never more regal than at this moment. How can we say that? Well, we have to look at what the definition of a king really is. What is a king? Is a king military might? Is a king wealth and fame? God gives us a good definition for what a king should be in the book of Ezekiel, and this is how he says it. He says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. Now, the context of that is that Ezekiel is blasting the leaders of the day, the kings of the day, because they weren't doing their job. They weren't looking after God's people. They weren't protecting them, defending them, providing for them. That's the job of a king. And so when we evaluate Jesus as king, that's what we've got to look at. Not the outward signs, not the trappings, not the wealth and fame and power, but the answer to this question. Is Jesus providing for and taking care of and defending his people? So now when we look at Jesus in that room with the soldiers, it looks quite a bit different, doesn't it? Because isn't that exactly what Jesus is doing? He didn't do this because, well, he thought it would be fun. He didn't do this to prove any kind of a point. He did this for you and for me, to save us from sin, Satan, and death. And so as he sits there silent as a sheep, not opening his mouth, not protesting, not fighting back, we can recognize that not as a sign of weakness and failure, but as a sign of tremendous strength. That Jesus would be so humble and so dedicated to his people that he's willing to sit there and take it. When those soldiers hit him again and again, when they spit on him, when they ridicule him, whip him, all the false accusations, everything. Jesus did it because he knew that's what we needed to happen if we were to be saved. So a show of tremendous strength from our Lord. And we know what the result was. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, Peter tells us in his letter, so that by his wounds we have been healed. Our Savior King did defend us. He fought our battle for us. And he came out victorious. And the only way for him to do that was by giving up everything. His very life. Could there be any better king than that? And so we say, Hail King Jesus. Be our king. That's the kind of king we need. And take our lives, Jesus. Let us live for you. And if that means a little suffering now, before I can enter into glory, so be it. Lord Jesus, you went through it. You can give me the strength to go through it. And so as we hail our Savior King, we also pray for his blessing upon us to help us through our journey. Brothers and sisters, don't get discouraged. Don't look at your life and wonder what's going on. Where is my God? He's right there with you. He's holding you up. He's defending you. So praise him. Pray to him. Hail him as your king. Amen. Please stand. And the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll continue by confessing our faith together. We're going to use the words of the second article of the Apostles' Creed. We'll read those words responsively. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. What does this mean?
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death. All this he did that I should be his own and live under him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. Just as he has risen from death and lives and rules eternally, this is most certainly true. Please be seated. We'll continue with our song of the season.
Afflicted saint, to Christ on me, your Savior's gracious promise hear. His faithful word you can believe, that as your days your strength shall be. The victory's won. God shall supply all that you need. Yet as your days, your strength shall be. Should persecution rage and flame, still trust in your Redeemer's name. In fiery trials you shall see that as your days your strength shall be. So sing with joy, afflicted one, the battle's fierce, but the victory's won. God shall supply all that you need. Yes, as your strength shall be. When called to bear your weighty cross, or sore affliction, pain or loss, or deep distress, or poverty, still as your days your strength shall be. So the victory's won. God shall supply all that you need. Yes, as your days, your strength shall be.
Please stand for prayer. We'll start by giving thanks to the Lord for the blessings he gives us and asking him to bless our gifts. And then we'll go into the prayer of the church. Also included in our prayers today is the sister-in-law of Renee Katia, who's been diagnosed with lymphoma. So we go to God on her behalf and her family. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts and the giving of our offerings all show our thankfulness to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever.
You are worthy, O Christ our King, to receive honor and glory and praise, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. You are worthy, O Christ our King, to receive honor and glory and praise, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased us for God. From every tribe and language and people and nation, you have called us into your kingdom and have made us priests to serve you, our God and Father. And so we ask, help us to live as royal priests. And we give thanks to you, O Christ, our Shepherd King, because you have searched for us and found us. Lead us to the green pastures and quiet waters of your saving love, so that we may enjoy peace and comfort for our souls. Heal our hearts when they are broken with sin and guilt. Strengthen us when we are weak. And we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. Come with your mighty power to break and defeat every evil plan and purpose of the devil, of the ungodly influences and ideas of the world, and of our own sinful natures. Use your power to calm the unrest among nations and peoples, so that your kingdom may spread and grow. Strengthen our confidence in knowing that your kingdom will never be destroyed. O Christ our King, you have supremacy over all. You will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. You have destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Reign in our hearts, that we may serve you more faithfully and speak more boldly to others of your saving love. Lord Jesus, we also recognize that you are Lord over life and death and over our bodies. You give health and take it away. And so we come to you on behalf of our sister in Christ, Karen Kruger, sister-in-law of Renee Katia, who has been diagnosed with lymphoma. We ask that you would give her strength during this time. Remind her of your love for her and that you are in control of all things, including this disease. We ask that if it is your will, that you would restore her to health, but that if it is not, you would continue to remind her that you are by her side, that you will give her strength to overcome, if not physically, then spiritually, because a crown of life waits for her in heaven. We also ask your blessing on her family. Keep them strong during this time of uncertainty. Remind them of your love for them and that you work all things for the good of those who love you. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever, King of kings and Lord of lords. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory. We also join to sing the prayer that he taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily
Go now with the blessing of our God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. We'll conclude our service with one final anthem by the ensemble.
I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. Spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Living love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. Gift you offer, free and undeserving, your blood and body for me, righteousness. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love,
amazing love.
Once again, welcome to everybody. Good to see you here in God's house. Good to have you guys online with us as well. There are a lot of announcements in our service folder, so I direct you to that. Please read through them all. There's a lot of things coming up as Thanksgiving and Christmas are approaching. Obviously, this coming week, Thanksgiving, and we have a Thanksgiving worship service Wednesday evening at 7 p.m., so remember that that's going on. And also, want to mention our call news. So we had called on the 15th for a principal, 7th and 8th grade teacher. We called Andrew Aguilar from California Lutheran High School. That's where he's serving currently. So keep him in your prayers. He's already having a lot of discussions with our people here. If you would like to get in touch and send him some encouragements, his email address is printed for you there in the service folder. Okay. Also keep in your prayers Rachel Severide, our 3rd and 4th grade teacher here, as she's deliberating calls whether she's going to remain here at Cross of Glory next school year or if she'll be going to Emmanuel in Tempe. They have called her to teach a 3rd grade over there. So keep her in your prayers. Her contact information is also there. Encourage you all to reach out to her and tell her your thoughts on where you think she should serve. I think we know. And then we've got other things coming up. Church decorating is a week from today, Saturday. So next Saturday, the 28th, 3 to 6 p.m. If you would, if you're interested, come on over and help us decorate the church in preparation for Advent and Christmas. And then other things coming up. Advent by candlelight on December 6th. Our voters meeting update is in there. Again, just a reminder that we had a landmark decision that approved us to go forward with our building project. And so that's a very exciting thing and lots of work to do there then. Communion update is in there too. This is the first weekend we're making this change. We had been doing communion every service after the service. Now it's just first and third Sundays, so our first and third weekends. So we will not be having communion tonight for those of you who are here, FYI. Live Nativity on December 13th. We're looking for volunteers yet for that, so please sign up if you're willing to help out with singing some carols or helping to set up or take down. Our elementary school is taking part in that as well, but we need some people from the congregation who would be willing to help out. And I'll leave the rest to you. There's a Vistancia Holiday Lights Tour. Put that on your calendar, Friday, December 18th. Another opportunity there for us to get known in the community and reach out to some people. So those are the announcements, among others, there in the service folder for you. God's blessings on your, yes? Oh, yes, we have the video for our 10 to 10 series continues, and we have a video to show you for further encouragement as we do our 10 for 10 enhanced giving program. So we'll watch that now.
Imagine that you were sitting in Jesus' seat and saw the widow about to offer her 2 copper coins. What would you have told her? No, dearie, God knows your heart. He knows you don't have 2 dimes to rub together. He knows you'll give it someday if you have it. Hey, here's some more coins. Go buy yourself a cup of coffee. It's likely we would have tried to talk her out of doing the very thing that Jesus commended her for. When is the last time that we gave in such a way that demonstrated real trust in God's ability to provide for us? For instance, at the church I serve, our financial secretary shared a study on giving. It showed that 87% of our members gave God, the creator of the atom, less than they give to the utility company, and that 67% of our members gave God, the creator of the human body, less than they give to a gym membership. There is only one reason why we fail to give God our first fruits. He simply isn't first in our heart. There is one overriding reason why we fail to practice proportionate giving. We've simply forgotten that God is the owner of 100% of his creation. And there is one significant reason why we fail to practice sacrificial giving. We've lost our appreciation for the depth of Jesus' sacrifice for us. So how do you think the widow's story ends? Scripture doesn't say. But knowing what you know about the faithfulness of God the Father and the sacrificial love of the Son, we certainly don't get the impression that Jesus let her go home and starve, because Jesus knows all about widows and their needs. Just 3 days after watching the widow give her gift at the temple, Jesus looked down from the cross upon another widow, his mother. Even with his hands nailed to the cross, he opened his hands and took care of her future needs. And to this day, he opens his crucified hands and fills our desires with good things. Jesus gave his all, his everything, his Son for you. He didn't offer 2 coins for your salvation, but the double treasure of Jesus' perfect life lived for you, and his innocent death died for you. In him, we have the forgiveness we crave and the motivation we need to open our hands and give in a way that glorifies God and cares for our neighbors. May God richly bless the results of our 10 for 10 emphasis to his glory and for the good of people dearly loved by him. Some of the people God dearly loves are your unchurched friends and neighbors. You want them to experience the same joy you experience because of your relationship with Christ. You know that they can only experience that joy if someone tells them what Jesus has done to give them eternal life. But if you are like many Christians, you aren't sure how to share the good news about Jesus. This is why our synod has a commission on evangelism. The commission on evangelism encourages and equips members just like you to proclaim the good news. It is yet another way your congregation mission offerings support the spread of the gospel. How exciting it is to think that God would use our gifts to assist in saving souls.